Good morning, good morning. Good morning. Good having you with us. If you will please stand. Only one verse to for our call to worship this morning as I was reading the Psalms earlier today. And I was in Psalm 3 and 4, one verse from Psalm 3, verse 8. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing is upon your people. And Father, we thank you that salvation is through you, that rescue, that deliverance from sin and death and the penalty of sin, not only death but hell. We thank you that you have come to rescue and deliver through your Son Jesus and Him alone. There's salvation in none other. We're thankful, dear God, for the many blessings that you pour out upon us. And Father, help us to utilize blessings that you pour out upon us. Help us to put those to use for your glory and for your kingdom. And Spirit of God, we pray you're leading now in this time of worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which word and art and evermore shall be. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see, only thou art holy, there is none beside thee, perfect in power, in love and purity. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. I was really torn. I was wanting to belt it out, sing, and yet I'd stop, and you guys, that was beautiful. Kristen's a little under the weather. That's why she isn't behind or at the keys today. But Kim, thank you for faithfully leading us in worship. That was just beautiful. This is my story. Everybody has a story. What are you all about? If a person was speaking with you, maybe a complete stranger, and yet for whatever circumstances you have to spend quite a bit of time together, maybe a few hours, would they know your story? Would they know what you're all about? For the Christian, what we are to be all about is God, his glory, his kingdom, right? Seeking first the kingdom of God. We were created by him, for him, to enjoy him forever, and I pray that our thoughts, our words, our actions really show who we are and show the world what we're about and what is our story. Speaking of story, we're going to look at another one that Jesus tells. Look at Luke chapter 16, going into Luke chapter 16 this morning. Luke chapter 16. I had probably four or five different titles. Didn't know what to entitle this. Somebody came up to me this morning and says, "Oh, I had a title for your message this week." I said, "Well, why didn't you send it to me? I was really struggling with titles anyhow." So the one we settled on was Christianity, a call to manage well. It's a parable of the unjust steward, the unjust manager. That's what most Bibles, many Bibles, have as a heading above this chapter, or for this section of the chapter. But let's look at this. Luke chapter 16, we're reading verses 1 through 13. Are we going to cover them all today? Let's see. He also said to his disciples, "There was a certain rich man who had a steward. And an accusation was brought to him that this man was wasting his goods. So he called him and said to him, 'What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be steward.' Then the steward said within himself, What shall I do? For my master is taking the stewardship away from me. I cannot dig. I am ashamed to beg. I have resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. So he called every one of his master's debtors to him and said to the first, how much do you owe my master? And he said, 100 measures of oil. Now this would probably be 800 to 900 gallons, if you will, of probably olive oil. So he said to him, take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Cut it in half. And he said to another, and how much do you owe? So he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, take your bill and write 80. So 10 to 12 bushels of wheat per measure. So that gives you an idea. Anyhow, take it and write it to 80. So the master commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of light. And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much, and he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Meaning really wealth and riches. Our Father, we thank you for this time together this morning. And thank you for that time of singing. I pray that it was pleasing to you. Your word tells us that you're enthroned into praises of your people. And I pray that you were pleased. We are thankful for you, the triune God, holy, holy, holy. And we thank you for the story that we can tell, the story of redemption, because of Jesus' sacrificial, substitutional offering, his death, burial, resurrection. Father, we thank you that he is at your right hand, living to make intercession for us, that he is our mediator. Thank you, Father, for all the blessings that we have as your children. And I'm thinking of an old song that says, every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. I pray not only turn back to praise, but that everything you give to us, you give us but your own, that we would turn it back and use it for your glory and your honor and for the furtherment of your kingdom. Teach us today. Teach us, and may your words find their marks in our hearts, our minds, our affections. Help us to not only be hearers of your word, but to be doers, to put it into practice. Help me to teach in a way, Lord, that is, first of all, accurate to your word, and second of all, that is practical and applicable. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And I do often pray, every week I pray for a starter, if you will. I think Steve Lawson calls it a front porch, where an inroad, a beginning, an intro. How's that? And so I was praying, I was thinking, this phrase, this old phrase came to mind, the means justify the end. I mean, you're familiar with that. What is really being said there, and how in the world does this tie in? Well, I do see it as a tie. The means justify the end. It's used to say that a desired result is so good or important that any method, even a morally bad one, may be used to achieve it. That's from Webster's Dictionary. And what we see of the unjust steward here is him working some means so that he would get the desired results. And so, I was thinking as a child of God, well, what is our desired result. What is it that we're after? What is the end? How many understands that? What is our main objective? What is our main goal? And as a child of God, it should be His glory, His honor, and the furtherment of His kingdom. And so that should bring everything into perspective. It should properly prioritize our lives. And so it should be a matter of understanding, yes, I'm in this world, but I'm not of this world. And as one writer, and I don't recall the name right now, we have 1 foot in this world and 1 foot in the kingdom. And Paul talks about that dual citizenship, that our citizenship is in heaven. So we're born from above, and yet we remain here. And so now our priorities and desires should be not so much for here, but the main desire, the main end that we have in mind is, again, God's glory, His honor, and His kingdom. And so the means, our everyday lives, our thoughts, our words, our actions should be working towards that end. How many understand? Okay, makes some sense? Good. Jesus, once again, is telling a story. He's, again, telling a story. And when He tells a story, when He tells a parable, when we were saved, which would have been 37, 38 years ago, I would have been the first time that I heard a definition of a parable being an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. And that's still a good definition. So a parable is an illustration to help explain, clarify, and to make a point. A parable could also be considered a comparison, to lay beside, so that, again, one can better understand. And Jesus often used parables to teach. And so here again, in this chapter, we're going to see a couple. But the one before us today, it begins with, "He also said to His disciples." And I think that needs some clarity, needs some explanation. When you think of His disciples, and you don't have to say this out loud, but I think a lot of times it's common to think of the 12 apostles first, right? And then maybe the 70, whoever they were, will meet Him in glory. But I think in this setting here, not to exclude the apostles or the 70, but in this setting, especially with what we were just seeing in the previous chapter, because I don't see this chapter ending, or chapter 15 ending, and then this finds us elsewhere. In chapter 16, He also said, so there's that connection. He also said to His disciples, which disciples are these? Well, very well could be the tax collectors and the sinners who came to saving knowledge of Christ, and now they're newbies, if you will. They're green. They're fresh, new followers of Jesus, and they need direction. Now, the story that He tells has application for all the disciples, the apostles, the disciples, and these newer ones. Right? We okay with that so far? And so He tells this story to them. And the story that He tells is before you. And basically, I'll try to summarize it. So there is a guy who was a manager of a rich man's finances. He managed. Okay? And he was a cheat. He was unjust. He was unrighteous. He had control of his master, of his managers, of the business owners' finances. He was in charge of them. Okay? And he was ripping his master off. That's what he was doing. We can all understand that. And trust me, every Jew that would have been there, and Gentiles as well, would have understood what Jesus was saying. They always understood as far as the illustration, the parable that he would use of everyday life things to drive home a spiritual point. They could relate to the parable. They could relate to the story. They could understand what was being said. And we know that because look at verse 14. Now the Pharisees who were lovers of money also heard all these things and they derided him. They understood what Jesus was saying in this parable. So anyhow, you have this man and he's wasting his master's goods. He's ripping the man off. And so he gets caught on the carpet one day. I remember years and years ago of managing it was a good feeling to get the call, hey, I need you to come to my office, knowing there wasn't anything he got on me. You know what I mean? Clear conscience. I don't know what this is about. I really don't know. So there is some concern. Well, what is this? But I, thankfully, you're not gonna dig up dirt on me. Well, this guy, he was probably always waiting for this call to happen, this email to take place, this text. Hey, Joe, get in here now. No Joe's here, I'm sorry. It's whatever. What's this I hear about you? What do you mean? You know exactly what I mean. What have you been doing? You've been ripping me off for years. I trusted you with this. Why? Well, once he was found out, what was he going to do? He wasn't a guy who was going to, he says, I cannot dig, verse 3. Whether he was not able to or just pride wouldn't allow him. And we also knew pride would keep him from begging. We see that in verse 3. I cannot beg and I'm ashamed to beg. So now he's in a dilemma. Which doing dishonest things will often get you there. A little lie here, a little cheating here. It will catch up. It will catch up with you. And I know we don't want to spiritualize this whole text and make a lot of speculation and such, but we do want to understand the point. It's dealing with unrighteousness is really what it's doing here, or what Jesus is teaching about. And it's really a warning to the disciples of how they are to conduct themselves as a child of God. So I've resolved what to do. Look at verse 4. We try to be quick with this part of it. So when I get fired, when I get canned, which here we go, I've got to work fast and I got to work smart because I got to save my tail somehow, right? So he calls in those who owed his master. And this ripoff artist was padding the books, charging interest, usury, which was not permitted for the Jews to do to one another. And so he had a cushion there to work with. So he calls the guy, hey, how much? He asked the person who the oil and the wheat was lent to. How much do you owe my master? I owe him a whole bunch, like 900 gallons. You know, and this is precious commodity with both these things. And again, it's just a story, but olive oil, wheat, staples, precious commodities. Well, I owe him about 900. Tell you what, let's just cut that right in half. Just between you and I. What? You'd do that? Sure, I'd do that for you. I'm doing it for you. Remember, I'm doing this for you. Not to hold it over your head or anything, but I just cut your bill in half. Remember that. You understand what he's doing, right? And you gotta remember this because in this story, he's commended for his shrewd and prudent and savvy business practices. And lest I forget, you and I are to be prudent. We're to be wise. We're to be shrewd. We're to be savvy in all of our dealing, but we're never to be shady in what we do, right? Sort of a disconnect, a little bit of a connection. Be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Now, he was dealing more with persecution when that comment was made, but still, there's a little bit of a connection there. So, of course, then he asks the next guy, what do you, man, I owe your master bushel after bushel after bushel after bushel of wheat. I'll tell you what, we're going to knock that down by at least 20% or so. What do you think of that? You'd do that for me? Oh, I'd do that for you. I would do that for you. Remember what I'm doing for you. Not to hold it over your head or anything, but I'm really cutting you a break. My job could be on the line, which it's already done. But remember who cut you the break. I might need something sometime. Remember. And that's really what's taking place here. So then we come to verse 8. So Jesus tells a story, and now he starts explaining. And now connection is made, application is made, the story is explained. Let's look at it. This is contemporary English version. Let's have the first slide of verse 8. The master praised his dishonest manager for looking out for himself so well. That's how it is. The people of this world look out for themselves better than the people who belong to the light. What is he saying here? Well, it's pretty clear. When it comes to people who do not know Christ, people who are in this world and are of this world, they can be pretty shrewd. They can be pretty prudent. They can be savvy. And especially when it comes to looking out for themselves, not just in the here and now, but in their future. And I don't mean eternal future, because that's void of their understanding. The only thing they can look ahead is the retirement days and think, I'm going to be set. I'm going to be set very, very well. And so Jesus is saying, this is how it is with the people of this world. They look out for themselves better than those who are of the light. So here's a comparison of two different groups of people, those who are not disciples of Christ and those who are disciples of Christ. And Jesus is saying, when it comes to the non-followers, when it comes to people of this world, man, they can be so shrewd. They look out well for themselves. Just like this unjust steward manager. We don't really use stewardship too much, but it's management. He got caught, but he acted wisely on how he was going to make a way for himself. And he's commended. And this, we can't draw the inference from this that God's commending unjust behavior. No, not at all. He's just saying that there are people who practice very, who are very prudent in their practice, who are very savvy in their dealings with others, and set for the purpose of setting themselves up well. Better than those who are of the light. Well, who are of the light? Well, that's where you should say the Christians of the light. That's exactly right. We have the light and life of Christ within. We have come to the true light, as John chapter 1 says. I think of Jesus' I am statement, where he says, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in what, church? Darkness, but shall have what, church? Oh boy, we need to work on that. John 8:12. You look at that. But shall have the light of life. Another verse came to mind in thinking about this, and not again to stretch one point too far. However, I think these are means of showing us where we're really at. Right now, to yourself, I don't want to hear it out loud, but are you a person of this world, or are you a child of the light? Again, we're in this world as Christians, but we're not of this world. We have dual citizenship. We live here now, but our citizenship is in heaven. Philippians 3:20, I think. So, are you a child of the light? Paul tells us in Ephesians 5, verse 8, for you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. So we are called, first of all, he's acknowledging that there was a time when we were not in the light, when we were in darkness. I don't know about you, but I remember those days. And I praise God that he brought me out of that darkness, into that marvelous light. But with coming to the light, now there is responsibility. And there are expectations of how we are to live. And there is stewardship, there is management involved. In fact, it is a call to manage well. Coming to saving knowledge of Christ and being ushered into his family, adopted into his family, becoming joint heirs with Christ, there is with that a calling to manage our lives well and everything that has been entrusted to us. But not only everything has been entrusted to us, not to only manage it well, but with that managing, to utilize it, to put it to use. And so, he also goes on to say in Ephesians 5, verse 14, therefore he says, awake, you who sleep, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. Okay, so the children of light. And what Jesus is saying is, they got it down. The people of this world got it down. They will go to no end. They put their resources to use, even to the point of immoral ways. But their means, they do justify their means because this is the end. This is the desire that I have. You and I, as children of light, are called to be every bit as shrewd and savvy with utilizing our resources for the end result, the desired result, and that again is what I've said it three times, the glory of God and the furtherment of his kingdom. But so many times, or at least it appears that way to me, profess to be Christian by name, but in listening and watching, observing, is the end, is the desired results really about those things of the glory of God and the furtherment of his kingdom? Is what has been entrusted to you being utilized for those purposes? Or at least, is that the main cause that you are living for and investing in? Yes, God has given us all good things to enjoy. And I am thankful for the good things that he gives me to enjoy. I am thankful for the numerous blessing day after day after day. However, I cannot allow, which is easy to do if we're not sticking close, clinging to Christ. It is easy for the things of this world to become so alluring that it draws our attention away from God and keeping him first. And the next thing you know, we find ourselves, I guess I'm really living for this world first and not this king and not the kingdom of God. Again, this story is a warning to these disciples. He's saying, I want you to learn a lesson. The same savviness, the same shrewdness, the same prudence, the same energy and effort that we see people of this world exerting for this short temporal time here on earth is how the child of God is to be about the kingdom of God and his glory. That, to me, is what I see the point being here. Let's look at verse 9. And again, I think it's in the Contemporary English Version, because I think it's a little easier to understand. My disciples. Now, who's he talking to here? And you got to keep in mind, there's a mixed bag of audience here. You've got the disciples. You've got probably just curiosity seekers, right? And you got the Pharisees. You got the religious bunch. But he's addressing the disciples, and all of them are listening, though. And then he's going to, of course, turn verse 14 and address the Pharisees. My disciples, there again, he's addressing them. I tell you to use wicked wealth to make friends for yourselves. Then when it is gone, you will be welcome into an eternal home. What is he saying here? He's saying, don't be lazy. Don't be complacent. Don't be apathetic when it comes to taking the resources that I have blessed you with and utilize them for the kingdom. Wicked wealth, or whatever it is, says here, wicked wealth, just really the wealth of this world. To take the things of this world and put them to good use for the kingdom. What does this mean? It means our money, yes. Other resources, yes. Time, energy, effort, all those things. So when we look back over a week's time, a month's time, how much was I about the kingdom of God versus this world? This is challenging, isn't it? As I was studying, this is challenging. And so to look back over a week or to look back over a month, we first have to look back. It's important that we look at each day and that we're mindful of this each day. The model prayer, the Lord's Prayer, is a good reminder where our affection is to be, where our focus is to be. Our Father in heaven. Gravity takes its toll, doesn't it? We were talking earlier today. How come it isn't the older you get, the further it is down there to pick up something, and the harder it is to get back up? Well, gravity takes its toll on us as far as taking our eyes off of God and His glory and bringing them down to here, into this temporal world. Yes, we need to work. Yes, we go about our day. Yes, there's time for recreation and all those things. But all those things are to be secondary. Do we understand that? We're children of light now. We're to be about light. We're part of the kingdom. We're to be about the kingdom. Enjoy the things of this earth, yes, but they are not to be our primary end. And our means better be means for the glory of God and His kingdom, and not the means to build my own little empire and my own kingdom. So he's saying, I tell you, use wicked wealth to make friends for yourselves. And so, in ministering to other people, we need to learn to use everyday life interaction, purchasing things, being around others in just everyday affairs, to seeing them those things and the circumstances that God places us in as opportunities to invest in the kingdom. And by making friends, inroads into people's lives, planting seeds, watering those seeds, that they too can become part of the kingdom, that we would be the means, if you will, God utilizing us and our resources to help other people come to saving knowledge of Him. How many get that? Just like the unjust steward, hey, buddy, I'll tell you what, let's just knock that in half. Well, you and I are not to be shady, but to say, hey, buddy, how are you doing today? And building conversation and building inroads and relationships with people to share the good news. How much investing are we doing in that way? We get so caught up in our portfolios and our investments, and a lot of people are down right now because the investments are down right now. But that becomes more priority for a lot of professing Christians than the kingdom and investing in the kingdom. It's not right. I had at least two people tell me last week, you really stepped on my toes. I don't know if I'll hear any of that today. And trust me, I come in here with bruised toes every Sunday before I get behind this pulpit or whatever this thing is. But we need to hear these things. So whether it was disciples that have walked with Jesus for 2.5 years or whether these were newer ones, whatever the case may be, it applies to you and I today. This is our story. This is our song. Our story is I'm a born-again child of God, and I need to be about His business. Do you have business? Do you have interest? Do you have wants, Scott? Or do you just sit at home in your study? I have a lot of interests. I have a lot of desires. I have a lot of things. But they're constantly being brought under the scrutiny of the Holy Spirit and say, keep me first, Scott. And use this as a means to tell others. Did you get that? Every day we have opportunities. Every day. Every day we can either invest in this temporal world or invest in the kingdom of God. We're called to be good managers. We're called to be good stewards. Then he shares an old adage, an old saying, most scholars believe it is anyhow, which is universally true. Look at verse 10. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And that's so. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. I don't know if you've had this experience. Most of us older people have, probably, where you do entrust somebody with something, just something small, and they don't make good use of it whatsoever. It's sort of like delegation in a sense. You know, sometimes it's just easier to do it yourself, right? But in this category, or in this verse, not category, wherever that came from, no one will prove themselves in time. If somebody isn't faithful in just a small thing, they're very likely not going to be faithful in a larger thing. And so Jesus, this is just like a proverb. We know this. And so in verse 11, therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, worldly wealth. In fact, how many of you used the word mammon this past week? That's just what I thought. Sometimes I get challenged about my translation and stuff. Come on, we don't talk like that. So why for an hour and a half a week we change our way and this and that? And, well, why? Why do we do that? Worldly wealth. Mammon, wealth is, or wealth, riches. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the worldly wealth, who will commit to you the true riches? God honors those who honor Him. God continues to pour out to those who put to good use what He gives to us. I mean, understand that. You do understand that all things are of Him, and we give Him but thy own. And you know, sometimes I'm a little off topic here, but not really. Sometimes the easier thing to do is to throw money at something. And I think a lot of Christians, I don't say a lot, but okay, they got the tithe thing down, a tenth. And then they're free to go. I gave my tithe. I went to church. I'm good to go. Did it ever occur to you that perhaps God has blessed you with much so that you can invest much? So quit using the tithe as a loophole. I gave my tenth. Is that what he asked us to give? God loves a cheerful giver. Paul talks about laying aside before the first day of the week. Lay aside as God has what? Prospered you. When we cling to money and mammon, worldly wealth, we're showing where our heart really is at. Do you realize that? That's foolish. As if we can control the future. As if we can control the future. I'm going to have this. This is mine. No, it's not. And God can take it away. Remember Luke chapter 12? The guy had all these things. He had so much, he didn't have room for it. I know what I'll do. I'm going to tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And God's word says, you fool. How many barns are we building? How many extras are we having? But I'm okay because I gave my tenth. Wow. And time and energy is the other thing. As for some people, it's easy to give a tenth. But to ask to give time, to invest energy, resources other than money, no. Why? Because I'm too busy in this temporal world. Wow. Well, here's... Again, in verse 12, if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? The other man's, in this story, is God the one who grants us these blessings, these gifts. He's the one who entrusts to us all that we have. And he calls us to use it for the fourth or fifth time for his glory, his honor, his kingdom. How are you doing with that? When's the last you really invested in the kingdom? How much time do you spend on the kingdom of God and his glory? Or is it just, let me throw this at that, and now I can live my life? No, your life, my life as a child of God, is to be all about the kingdom. And as he allows us to enjoy things in life, which he does, praise God, he does, great. But that stuff is secondary. That's not first. Again, it goes down to the seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these other things will be added on to you. I don't know about you, but is that clock dragging by? How much more do we have to take? He's got us in the corner putting the gloves to us. That's how I feel upstairs right now. Well, we only have a couple more verses left. Of course, we've got to look at verse 13, and then let's do that. No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money, or mammon, depending on your translation. So here's a comparison. And here's what we're called here's a warning. And with this warning, we see a comparison. There, that is that we can only be loyal to one and not another. And so it's either going to be God or it's going to be money. Either I'm going to be a servant to worldly wealth, to temporal life, or I'm going to be a servant to God and his kingdom. But you can't serve both. You can't love. You can only love one primarily. You can only love one supremely, right? The other is going to be insubordinate. The other one is going to be secondary. And so this is application in itself right here. Who are you serving? Are you serving worldly wealth, money, this world, or are you serving God? Is your love and your loyalty to God first and foremost? That's what Jesus is saying here. And to think these young disciples, I don't young in age, but new in the faith, and the others have been listening to him again for going on 3 years. They're registering this. They're processing this. This is what Christianity is. It is indeed a call to manage well. How are you doing with that? How are you doing with that? Well, here's a couple verses that I want to share with you to close our time together. Please, from the Sermon on the Mount, and Luke chapter 12 brings something into it similar to this too. Do not lay up for yourselves treasure on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and thieves break in and steal. Now that doesn't say that you can't put something aside. That's wise. To plan is wise. But where is your heart with that is the question. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. What's he getting at? He's saying to lay up your treasure. If your treasure's all here, do you realize how much at risk it is? That today you're happy, joy, because you have everything. You got the world by the tail. You've got a good investment. Everything's going great. And then it all could be taken just like that from various means, by various means. So instead of doing that, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. So, dear ones, what are you investing in? Can the Christian say both? Yes. But only one can be first. I mean, understand that. Are you investing in the kingdom? Is your treasures, what's really most important to you, is your end, your desired result, the things of God, and the future world, the new heaven, the new earth that will be coming? Or are you banking, squirreling away simply for this world? That's foolish. Things can happen just like that. I ministered to a family this week, and their loved one is now gone. There's no promise for the rest of this day. If all you have are temporal treasures, you're going to be eternally ruined. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Why? Because nothing can affect them there. You and I every day are storing up. But are you storing up for the things of this world or the things of glory? I close with this verse. Did he say close? Yes, I said close. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. How we spend our worldly wealth, how we spend our time, our energy, even how we spend our time thinking and doing will be the telltale sign of where our treasure is. You say, well, you're just a holy roller. You're just a nut. That's not the Christianity I want. No, it's not nominal Christianity. It's biblical Christianity. This is what Jesus calls us to. And the world is full of nominal Christians by name, but not by deed. Let's stand. Father, show us through your word, through this time together, examine our hearts. Show us where our loyalty lies. Show us where who or what really holds first place. Who or what we love the most. May we heed the warning that Jesus gave to these disciples. As followers of yours, may we heed it. And Father, help us this day to resolve, to be resolved, that if we're not seeking first your kingdom, if we have allowed this world to encroach upon us, the ways of this world to slowly cause us to go astray and to be satisfied with, I go to church on a Sunday or most Sundays, or I give of a tithe or close to that. No. Help us to see what really is our drive, what really is our story. And if we profess to be your followers, help us to live as your followers for your glory, your honor. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will, while I am waiting. Yielded and still, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with thy spirit till all shall Christ only, always living in me. Fill with thy Spirit till all shall see.
Father, I pray that that would be sincere desire of our hearts. Thank you for bringing us out of darkness and being now children of light. And help us to live as children of light. Help us to live for your glory, your honor. Help us to show the good news of Christ in us, not just tell of it. Show it by the way we speak, the way we conduct our everyday lives. Help us to be good managers of what you have entrusted to us. And Father, help us from being deceived and drawn away because of the riches of this world. Help us to stay focused first and foremost on you, and that you would always remain the treasure, the true treasure of our hearts until we are forever with you. We thank you and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.